Hi Matt.
Hi, Sadek.
So I thought you've been in Europe for your conference,
Yeah.
the Jamstack conference.
Yeah.
Was it good?
It was amazing. It was amazing. 400 people sold out in London. Great energy. Lots of new partners and vendors in the space showing up, and a lot of enthusiasm and inspiration and great speakers.
Cool.
Yeah.
And I like that you organize these kind of conferences. And it comes back to the vision that I really like. So basically, we
Thanks.
wanted to have you here because, Prismic, we sell a CMS, right? It's a SaaS service for CMS. And
Great product.
well, thank you. And our users, they can't do Prismic alone. They need a framework and they need to host it somewhere. And we thought, like, okay, what are the good services around that we can, advise them about and bring some good people to talk about what they're doing. And we like the strategy of what you guys are doing at Netlify,
Thank you.
basically having these kind of services that complete what you want to do with the website, right? You have authentication, forms, now analytics, and other things. So can you tell us a bit about your vision and what you're trying to do with Netlify?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean the core idea to Netlify really came from a lot of experience in the space of building websites and web projects at different kind of companies and different kind of settings, and then seeing this change in the architecture of the web that started happening some years ago, where we really started decoupling the front end presentation layer from the back end layer. And the back end layer itself started splitting from some big monolithic application with everything inside to all these different services, where some are microservices you build yourself, some may be serverless functions, and some are services like Prismic or Algolia or Stripe that you use for different functionalities directly from the browser. So we started seeing that sort of architectural shift happening, and we saw that all the sort of existing platform for developers was at that time really built around the traditional concept of you have your
One thing.
server and your database, and that's where it all starts, right? And we felt that everything was going to start in a different way with just your front end and your build tool, whether you're building a single page application and talking to a bunch of APIs, or you're building a generated website and putting it directly on a CDN and fetching the content from somewhere else, or still having dynamic parts of the site that needed for search or payments or stuff like that. So we saw that we really sat down and thought about how would the right platform look like if that was the starting point. And that's how we came up with the concept of Netlify, and also why we started talking to a lot of people building these services, whether it was the site generators or the single page application framework or the headless CMSs and so on, and started seeing also that there was some need for a way of even talking about that architecture and having some words around it. And the word sort of Jamstack started emerging, standing for JavaScript API and markup, right? Like really, really
And we'll get back
symbolizing.
to the Jamstack.
Yeah,
But
yeah.
I noticed something that you tell often. You
Yeah.
said, like, this platform, you talked about a platform,
Yeah.
whereas, like, from the outside, if you look at a Netlify, you might think it's a hosting company,
Yeah, yeah,
and that's
yeah.
very different from
Yeah.
just being a hosting company. You're thinking about the
Absolutely.
whole picture.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think it's also a question that we just saw that, again, if this was the way people were going to build sites, then some of the existing categories were going to shift a bit, right? Like hosting versus CDNs used to be two very different things, right? Like you always had your CDN that would sit in front of something else, right?
Right.
You had your CI/CD system that was completely different from those parts of the puzzle, right?
Right.
And we started seeing with this kind of project for your front end, you always want this kind of you always want this build pipeline, right? Like you always end up having some kind of build tool or some kind of transformation or some kind of site generator. And you always want the final result not to live in some single server somewhere. You want it distributed all over the world. And then once you start doing that, you start seeing, okay, then when we no longer have our traditional web server, where do we do things like redirects or proxying or geolocation or split testing or authentication or things like that, right? Well, now you need to do that directly off the edge. So that means the edge needs to start having some new capabilities and you need some new tooling around it, right? The same question you could ask with a like with a tool like analytics, right? Like, how do we get insight into the traffic if it's now distributed on servers all over the world? You no longer have your server to put your server log on and start analyzing, right? So now we launched an analytics product looking at our server logs from the edge, right? But again, it's kind of part of the same strategy of just keep answering the questions of like, okay, if we take sort of the logical like conclusion of this being the main architecture and the way we build websites, what do developers really need?
It's a big change, but it seems to be not so hard to understand, I guess, for developers. It seems to be like you don't have to completely understand the whole architecture. You can start simple, right? You can start with some kind of website that generates to static, and you're fine here. And then at some point you say like, oh, I need authentication. And in Netlify would say, you can have that. And it's very easy to set up on your website because, you know, we know your project and we can add it to it. And you say like, but my marketing team knows some forms. You can have that. And you can add it, and you keep adding these CDN things on top of it until you complete your project.
It also mirrors sort of our go-to-market strategy, right? Which has been very, very bottom-up. Like, how can we make something that's immediately useful to as many developers as possible, and then build on top of that, right? And then have a depth to the platform that makes it usable also when we're talking to our big clients, like whether it's Citrix or Verizon or Peloton or whatever, right?
Right. So to be able to use Netlify, is there any particular framework that I should be using, or what's necessary so that I can start using for our clients, for instance?
So for clients using Prismic, right, like there you will typically, there you'll really often have clients that are using some kind of site generator, right? Like that, like once you have like a content backend, it's very often the outcome you want to build is something more like a content-driven website, right? So in our end, we've always had the saying like that we're religious when it comes to the architecture, but completely unopinionated when it comes to the tooling itself, right? So whether you use Hugo or Gatsby or Eleventy or Nuxt or ViewPress or your own homemade site generator in Rust, we'll accommodate that, right? Like the important part is that you decouple the front end from the back end. And then of course we're seeing these like players emerging. Obviously, Gatsby has become big from being the first one in that space that's raised funding and built a company around it, which has its own set
and
of
now
challenges.
But now Nuxt is like doing static export.
And
Next
and
is doing the same.
Everyone Nuxt is. And Next has really emerged as some of the strongest contenders also in building like a static core, but then having all these dynamic functionalities around it, which is a very
interesting mixture, right?
And I think also like the emergence of serverless functions has played a big role in those kind of hybrids coming out, where you say, okay, let's see how much we can build that's just pre-built up front and distribute directly on the CDN. And then for the small parts that where we can't do that, well, let's just delegate to some serverless function where we still have a little bit of the same characteristics of static assets in terms of like as a developer, you don't have to worry about your server or where it runs, right? Like you just write the code.
And we'll get back to the serverless topic.
Yeah.
We'll make a video
Absolutely.
For it. But you know, it's like I feel that there, you know, we get to the same basically goal, but from two different directions. Like some people get the framework. Gatsby, and they try to go, okay, we can make it a bit dynamic in some places and all.
Yeah.
And you go from rather the hosting, you know, or like, okay, you host it here, but then we can give you the services to complete your project. Coming from two different directions, but meeting somewhere in the middle where things are static and dynamic in the
absolutely,
same time.
Absolutely,
right?
Absolutely. And we always saw it as our job sort of to help the whole ecosystem around. Again, we chose very early on to not try to build our own site generator or our own JavaScript framework or anything like that, and rather just see that's where like the real like grassroots community was, right, around all these open source projects, whether it was like early on projects like Gatsby and Hugo and so on, and then they've just proliferated more and more and more, right? And we just saw like how can we be really helpful to that whole ecosystem, right? Like how can we it's also why we have a very generous free tier, right? We've always
What I like about it is that it's not generous and kind of tricky, trying to kind hide something. No, it is, and you know, you're happy about the providing it. It's not like you're trying to trick people into anything. And we try to do the same. Like the free is free, and we're not trying to trick you into at some point finding a limit and being scared. No, it's really what it says. Right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and it's again, it's always been with this philosophy of like, if we could find this magic button that would say, like, if you're actually just a developer using it for developer stuff, like, then you shouldn't pay because that's absolutely not the market we're trying to trigger, right? Like, and if you're a business using it for real, well, then that's where it would make sense that there was a payment involved, right? And it's hard to know because you can't always know from the use case. Like,
we spent 2 years in Prismic having this developer for free, so you tell us whenever you go to production, but it doesn't work that way.
No, people
forget sometimes, or like they go in production, they don't tell us about it.
Yeah, so you have to sort of try to identify, okay, what's the use of the product that will be different between these two use cases, right? And that takes a lot of time, and you spend a lot of time finding the right or the wrong levers and pulling and pushing them onto the fail, like, okay, this is the thing that differentiates
between the two. And then you'll have some users telling you, I need it, I'm a developer. And it's like, okay, I don't know.
Yeah.
And the other thing that I was thinking of is like when you started all that, and I guess for you, it was 5 years ago or something?
Yeah, depending how you count. but yeah, like we launched... We launched Netlify itself out of private beta in March 2015. So that was sort of the official launch. And before that, I had been running a small MVP in the space called BitBalloon. That was sort of the predecessor. And before that, I ran a CMS company that was like a fully, you know, the traditional monolithic model where every request comes in and there's like a web server and a web application and a database and everything, right? But multi-tenant and in the cloud. And sort of like that was sort of the basis where I started seeing, oh, things are really like the architecture is going to change. I started seeing people like you guys building just the decoupled headless CMSs, and I started seeing like there's some other layer to that that's not there yet, right? Like, which is more about the actual presentation layer.
Yeah, my story was completely different. I was in the framework side, I was doing play framework and all. I thought, like, framework is nice, but now everything is getting, you know, broken into services, and you know, it's better to go like invest into the services side and to offer like services that are ready. You don't have to host them, and you know, you start right away.
Yeah.
So my question was, when you started Netlify, didn't people tell you, oh, another hosting company, and compare, like tell you like there's only Heroku and that
oh,
that,
yeah.
and why are you
oh,
doing
yeah.
the same thing again?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it took a while, like. I mean, it's been a fun journey that way, right? Because early on, we started this thing, and we started seeing that, but it's a new category happening, right? Like, things are really going to change. Like, this decoupling of the front end of the back end, it's going to disrupt a lot of how this tooling looks like. We started coming up with, like, talking to a few people that really got it, like people like Tom Preston Werner that had built Jekyll and GitHub Pages and GitHub itself, right? Like, he was in a good position to sort of say, yeah, I believe that's happening, right? The founders of Heroku actually also really got it early on and became some of our early angel investors. Founders of Rackspace Cloud was the same, right? So there was actually quite a few people that were really deep in the sort of hosting and automation space that got it very fast. But then outside of that, like, there was a lot of people looking at those, like, and saying, I mean, it was funny to have people say, but isn't that just like Heroku, and being like, yeah, but there's a reason the founders of Heroku invested in us, right? Like, and we sort of really had to go and shout to everybody that wanted to hear about it, about this decoupling and the Jamstack and so on. And now I feel we're in a very different place where people has really seen that, yeah, it's happening. Like, that architecture is here, and it is going to have a huge effect. And now everybody's sort of starting to look into, does it really mean?
And I feel that there is a shift of, let's kind of the focus that you need to be doing in the beginning.
Yeah.
Like, for instance, we had to defend that kind of vision to tell them, like, headless is a thing.
Think about it.
And now everyone is into it. And now we should tell, like, okay, that's cool. Yeah. Everyone is into it. That's a good thing. But now, how can you differentiate from your competitor around you?
Yeah, it's been interesting, right? You see it from the sales side as well, where initially it's very much about, like, initially once we talk to enterprise sales, we would be very careful of mentioning terms like the Jamstack and so on, because it would risk seeing esoteric or anything like that, right? And have had a lot of work to do, always like showing other examples and education and so on. And now now we are more seeing big enterprises contact us and ask about the Jamstack, right? Because developers are already bringing it up.
I can relate to that,
And they've sort of already decided to adopt the architecture, and they just come like and ask questions of us as a provider, right? Like, so that's been an interesting change.
Cool. Next video, we do serverless.
Yes.
Thanks.
Sounds good.